I'll turn to hymn number 397. Hymn number 397. We'll stand and sing all four verses. 397.
Tonight.
Amen.
I know that y'all want to go ahead and sit down as quick as you can. Gonna work so hard today. Found out my sister-in-law was raking leaves yesterday and tore her legs up. That's what my wife was telling me. Are you starting to heal? Praise the Lord. Keep her in prayer. We got to keep the Height family in prayer.
Amen.
Mr. Height's still in the hospital, from what I understand, right? And there's a couple other families in the church. One had fallen, and another one...
Jerry had a heart catheterization on Monday. Jeff McGinnis fell at work today. He was in the ER. And Angela Boyson has throat surgery tomorrow.
Wow. So when we think we're going through it, other churches are having...
They're just
going to
have service at the hospital. That was my
record. That'd be good. Well, let's go, Lord, in prayer, and praise God you could be here. Let's pray that God will just open our hearts and minds and receive the word of God. Amen. Brother Mark, could you pray for us, please?
Praise the Lord, Heavenly Father. We'd like to bring us out tonight. We'll just be with us, watch over us. Lord, live in our hearts and our minds.
Thank you, Lord. Talent show, which is going to be March 23rd. Amen.
Amen.
So have a talent or make up one. Amen. It's supposed to be a good time.
Amen.
So we can laugh at each other. Of course, I know we live in a politically correct society. I was thinking about coming in as a strip of bacon. Amen. Let's see if I can attack Mark. Amen. But, anyway, you just need to be funny and have a good time. Amen?
Amen.
So think of something and be a part of what's going on that evening. And March 17th, I know I'm going backwards, we have our food and fellowship prayer meeting. How many enjoyed that?
It's the 13th.
Right?
I'm going to guess that it's the 13th.
Okay.
Are you sure? I feel like it's the 13th.
Okay.
That's a rebellious thing. Amen. Ladies Bible study tomorrow at 10 a.m. Sharon is going to be hosting it. Amen. And gospel singing is going to be 7 p.m. The Colburn family. I haven't heard from Mike. Anybody heard from Mike? Need to give him a call to see how he's doing. Praise the Lord. I'm sure that that pain is terrible, especially this weather. Makes it even worse. And then don't forget about our potluck popcorn preaching on March 31st in nursing home. Amen. I'm praying that I might be able to go this time. I really miss going over there. And then we do have our revival meeting that's changed. If you want to mark that someplace else, it's going to be May 19th. Through the 22nd, possibly, right through the rest of the week, but we'll see how that works out. You know who's going to be here is Brother Doyle.
Amen.
Amen. The guy from Missouri. And Wendy Good.
Amen.
Yeah, he's 7 foot tall. And I got to talk to his wife, and we talked for only 45 minutes. But you need to pray for her also. She had a... brain tumor, and they weren't sure if it was cancerous or not, and they were able to take it out, and she's recovering now, and her name is Tanya, so keep her in prayer also, and praise the Lord that that came out great, and so I'm looking forward to him being here for that week, aren't you?
Amen.
How many people remember Brother Doyle? I would have had him back sooner, but I was sick, and just didn't stay in communication with him. So, praise the Lord that that's working out. Game night, looking forward to that on April 19th. Aren't you?
Yes.
I had your calendar somehow that you could be here for all that stuff. And somebody have a game that you can beat Charles with. No, I mean, you can beat him in it.
First, like, I like baseball.
We're going to learn English in our Sunday school class, so praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Tomorrow after college day, I'm going to visit Mary. She didn't come home. She's in Riverside Rehab. But we had said something Sunday, we're going to take her fruit basket. And I know Miss Laura wasn't here. So if you come into Bible study in the morning and you want to bring a couple pieces of fruit, bring it and put it in.
Can I give you cash?
But I got some cash too. I love Chick-fil-A. No. That's fine. Yeah, because I got to go tonight or in the morning and get something too.
Well, amen. Let's turn to hymn number 432. Hymn number 432. Stand and sing all four verses. 432.
Thank you.
that the Lord has allowed me to give to you about replacement theology. For you that have been here, I'm sure that you have no issue with it anymore.
Amen.
Amen. So we don't need to worry about those kind of things, but it's always good to refresh yourself.
Sure.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I'm going to be teaching you about being approved of God. Wouldn't that be anything?
Amen.
So we are going to go to 2 Timothy, and then I'll go ahead and share with you as I go along. And I will preach some of that.
Amen.
Preachers aren't supposed to say they're sharing things. Amen. Already 2 Timothy 2:15. I know most of you know this by heart. Study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rather dividing the word of truth.
Amen.
But shun profane, vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer for the message of Brother Charles.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, Lord. We surely thank you for the instruction that we receive from your word, Lord.
Amen.
That you would help us to pay attention to what you have for us, Lord, through our pastor this evening. Lord, we surely all want to be a part of you. That's why we're here. Lord, we're not just here to put on a show.
That's right.
We want to please our Savior and our God. Mm. Lord, I pray that you would just be with everyone here. Lord, encourage them, strengthen their hearts and minds tonight in your word.
Yes.
Give the pastor an unction from on high. Lord, fill them with the Holy Ghost and the power to speak exactly what you want said.
Amen.
Lord, help us to have hearts to receive and do something with what we hear tonight. We'll thank you for it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Well, that's not Sunday. I want to hand you some things tonight that you can put in your Bible later or keep one. That way, if you're going to be a real Bible student, then we need to understand the historical value of God's Word. And as you listen tonight, I don't have all the answers, and I certainly didn't like all the information, but I certainly agree with a lot of the stuff that I had gotten and studied over the years. The Bible is not only the Word of God, but it's a historical book. Y'all agree on that? And of course, we're going to demonstrate tonight, as we start this journey down this area of looking at the Word of God historically, is going to change the Word of God. So it's going to make it even that much more real to us. It's kind of warm here, isn't it? Amen. So if you would hold this just for a little while, and then I'll tell you how you can use it, amen, as we get into the Word of God. So anyway, we need to be able to study biblical history. Amen? And so with that, I know as I've been alive long enough now as a saved man of God, that I've watched the Bible being presented or portrayed in movies.
Yeah.
And there's movies coming out all the time. I think History Channel's got a new one about Jesus Christ. And it's very tempting to want to sit down and watch those things. And I know the Passion of Christ, most Christians had gone to the movies to see that. And they were moved by it. And what I mean, they were moved, some people, to tears.
Right.
If you watch stuff like that, it's going to grab your heart, especially if you know Jesus Christ is your Savior. Amen?
Right.
And so I'm not rebuking anybody tonight to go ahead and watch those things. It's entirely up to yourself. Amen? But there's all kinds of movies today that you can buy. There's older ones that you can pick up. I remember a lot of them portraying Paul and Peter and different disciples of the Bible. And they were really interesting to watch. And I like to watch it because they would depict some of the ways that they live
sure.
and travel.
Right.
And I looked at that and said, that'd be a nice way to live.
Sure.
But I don't know. Amen? Amen. That has to be a choice that you make. And then there's a lot of books. You agree?
Yeah.
If you don't believe me, go over and see my library. I got more books about the Bible. I think you could write chapter after chapter, book after book, and all kinds of books about the Bible.
Yeah.
And a lot of us read them. There's books to tell you how to have a better family. Dr. Rice in particular has written 4 books that I read, and I read them because I wanted to teach families how to get along with one another.
Sure.
And he has some good ideas. And of course, not only about family, about marriage, and there's all kinds of books out there by Barnum and different people that have written all kinds of ways to keep your marriage together. There's financial books. I think there's at least 50 that I know about off the top of my head.
Yeah.
And some of them I took opportunity to teach, but I know that if a person doesn't tithe, his finances won't be right.
Amen.
So that's one of the best ways to keep your finances in order.
Yep.
Amen. At least that works for me. Amen. Praise the Lord. And so anyway, you know, there's a lot of them out there. There's a lot of them that's not telling the truth.
Yep.
We have gone through replacement theology and all of the theologies that are out there today. You have Mormon books, you have Jehovah's Witness books, you have Catholic books, we heard of some books in Sunday school. I mean, there's just all kinds of books.
Yep.
And they seem to have more attention in our lives than the Word of God. Now, be careful with that. Amen?
Right.
But then there's all kinds of Christian haters out there today that are writing books that are against the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yep.
Against the church, against Christianity. If you listen to most liberal news stations, they don't want anything about God to be anywhere or any place. Amen. They want it gone. And you know, they can't help it. That's just the way it is. They're just insane.
Yes.
They can't help it.
Amen.
Baby killers and everything.
Yep.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yep.
And then there's our churches. It ought to hold supreme place. Amen. In our church, the Bible, the Word of God, not books.
Right.
Are you there with me? Especially the King James Bible.
Amen.
And I know that a lot of places out of the Bible, there's lodges like the, what do they call those lodges? What's the name of it?
Ski
Lodge. No.
Freemasons?
What is it?
Freemason.
Moose Lodge. Elks Lodge, all kinds of lodges, and some of them, really pay attention, or let's say they know something about the Bible.
Right.
And they've got literature out about the Bible. As they belly up to the bar and drink.
Okay.
Amen. Right. They're honored. I mean, now I'm telling you this because you need to be aware that even in our legislative hall, there's all kinds of information about the Bible.
Yep.
And we even have people in the legislative business that use the scripture inappropriately to get their point across.
Yep.
Amen?
Yes, sir.
You know where I am.
Amen.
And I know it's interwoven all through our society. Even still today, we have Christmas. We have Easter.
Sure.
We have all those things. And, of course, all that has some historical value in their minds.
Right.
It's all through modern literature.
Yeah.
I know if you go to college, maybe not today, there were books that they would expect you to read, literature that you would have to learn back in those days.
Right.
But it really had, it hadn't talked about the Bible. And what I'm getting at, a lot of these people would apply their historical view. And we have no idea what they're really saying, so we have to believe somebody.
Amen.
You know where I'm at?
Yes, sir.
So with that, directly or indirectly, it creates these books create 10 times what we have in the Word of God.
Right.
Or maybe even more.
Sure.
And so this book that we have, praise God, amen,
is
known all over the world.
Absolutely.
It's written in all kinds of languages. I don't know how many. But I know it's written in all kinds of languages right now. I think they're trying to put a good Spanish Bible together.
Yes.
The Spanish Bibles that they had, they were they were inaccurate.
Yep.
They were written from another Bible, from another version.
Yes.
That is translated from another version. And there's all kinds of Bibles that are written in different languages, if you will. But it's all out there, isn't it?
Yes,
And so what I'm getting at is, so there's all kinds of historical ideas that are being written.
Sure.
And if you don't know the Bible, you might buy into it.
Right.
Like the movie.
Sure.
And say, well, that's got to be right. You don't get it. You don't know how I feel.
Right.
And you know, most of that stuff does get your emotion.
Absolutely.
You know, if you watch the Passion, I think it was, mm-hmm. and I got to see some of the, I think it was on a video about that, and I'll tell you, to see Christ get beaten up like that grabs a hold of you.
Sure.
Doesn't it?
Yes.
But you got to see where it's happening, and you got to see the historical value of it.
Right.
And if you're not seeing it from the historical biblical value, you're going to be led astray.
Right.
And you're going to say, well, I might believe that. So we need to study the Bible historically.
Amen.
Now, I know we need to study the Bible.
Sure.
Right.
Praise the Lord. You're all with me. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. So we need to study Bible history. And because why? Because I believe that most Christians don't know it.
Amen.
And you got to be honest with yourself tonight. Now, I'm not saying that I've arrived, but there's still a lot that I need to know, and I need to know the historical value of it. Amen.
Amen.
And Christians read too many books,
yes.
not the book.
Right.
And I know there's a lot of information, I keep saying it out there, that
sure.
seems to go ahead and agree with what I want to agree with.
Sure.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And so we become afraid to go ahead and take the Bible, and I'm going to give you some areas tonight that will help you to go ahead and study the Bible, and we're going to go a long way with this.
Amen.
Amen. I think it's going to take us a little while.
Amen.
So most read the Bible to study it.
Sure.
It's okay.
Yes.
We need to study it. That's what we just read, didn't we?
That's right.
But unfortunately, our information, or let's say our study, is superficial.
Right.
And I know that. It's fragmented.
Yep.
Sometimes I think I've heard it said we run rabbit trails. Because there's something that gets our attention.
Right.
Bible college students learn how to outline the Bible.
Right.
Sometimes, I know that I was taught some time ago that you need to have 3 points in a poem. Amen? You need to know hermeneutics and homiletics, and you need to know, you know what I'm talking about, Ryan? You need to know all that stuff so that way you can prepare a sermon. I was never taught that I needed to know the historical value of what's going on in the Bible. I learned, like a lot of Bible college students did, that to outline the history that I needed to know about Egypt, Persia, Greece, and Rome. And that's not exactly true.
No.
Right.
Are you understanding me tonight?
Amen.
So how many college students I've met over here, they have given intelligent accounts of Abraham, Moses, and David, and if you will, Isaac and Jacob, given all kinds of facts, all about Paul and John in the Bible. I mean, they just lay this stuff out, but they have no historical idea of what they're talking about.
Right.
I'm not trying to be mean,
sure.
and I'm not saying everybody's like that.
Of course.
But what I'm saying to you tonight, child of God, and I'm really saying this to you in all seriousness, is that we have to get a hold of Bible history.
Amen.
Right.
That is out of the Word of God.
Amen.
Biblical history.
Yes.
Amen. And you say, well, how do I do that? I'm going to try to help you. And I have given you some, let's not go there yet, amen. So we need to study the Bible. Why? Because it has a historical plan.
Amen.
It does.
Absolutely.
What are we studying about? The Jews.
Yes.
And if we understand what the Bible talks about when it comes to the Jews, then we're not going to get messed up with all these other kind of theologies.
Amen. That's right.
So we know that the Bible is mostly written to the Jew.
Right.
And what's going to be happening in her life.
Yes.
So I did discover this. It's not logical. The Bible is not logical.
Of course not.
And nor is it scientific. Although it has a lot of science.
Right.
And a lot of logic.
Right.
Amen. What's it about? It's all about redemption.
Amen.
Right from the very beginning of Genesis all the way through Revelation. If you study it for yourself, you begin to see, right from the very beginning, you're going to see what the Bible has as a plan. So
right.
you agree with that?
Yes.
So we need to study the Bible historically. Can I say that again?
Amen.
We need to study it historically.
Right.
And if we're honest with ourselves, we're not doing that.
Right.
We can read the Bible. We can get direction from it.
Sure.
We can get conviction.
Sure.
And I don't like conviction.
No.
No.
And of course, conviction is what we ought to be getting from the Bible.
Amen.
Amen. Are you there with me? Not preference,
right.
but real conviction.
Amen.
to know how to live as a child of God. And we can learn all about the different characters in the Bible. We know about Job. We know about, who is the other guy? Jonah. Mm-hmm. Amen. We know all about those people.
Sure.
That most people know about.
Right.
And we think somehow we've arrived.
Right.
We missed the boat.
Amen.
Get it, Jonah, the boat. But if we don't use the Bible study as we study it from a historical point of view, we're not going to get all the connections.
Amen.
And people can interject what they want,
right,
wherever they want to interject it.
Right.
And we miss what God really has for us when it comes to a plan. So the Bible, without historical value, that is, that we are unfortunately messing with it as a masterpiece or a let's say a piece of art.
Right.
Could you imagine taking one of Angelo's paintings, Michelangelo's paintings? Mm. Could you imagine getting a big painting worth millions of dollars like that, and you just think it's a wonderful thing? You can't help but telling people about it, right?
Sure.
So what you do is you start breaking off pieces of it. And I give a piece to Vanessa, give a piece to Ron. I'm going to say I give you all a piece, right? Some of you have a cloud, piece of a cloud. Some of you have a piece of maybe a shrub. Maybe some of you have a finger. A stone. And I give you all these pieces, and you're going to think, wow, that's precious. But what I'm doing to the painting is I'm tearing it up.
Right.
Because I'm not giving you the whole painting.
Amen.
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 And so that's what most of us, when we sit down and study the Bible, we're taking this piece and that piece and passing it to this one and passing to that one.
Right.
It's beautiful.
Right.
But if we don't have the whole masterpiece, we don't have what God has for us.
Amen.
Amen. And so we have to be careful with that. It's awesome, isn't it? We need to know about Abraham.
Absolutely.
And Moses and their time frame, David and Paul. And we need to comprehend the Abrahamic covenant,
amen,
as we've been studying. Amen. And all the scenes on Sinai and Calvary. If we could get the picture of that and the time is going on. If we could get an idea of what it was like for Paul in his time in the book of Acts to preach on Mars Hill. Could you imagine that? And understand why it took place and where it took place and what God is doing through it. Can you say amen?
Right.
And we could get the whole picture of what God's doing historically, and it'd be so uplifting. It'd be so exciting.
Yes.
The Bible is exciting.
Amen.
It's a masterpiece. It's beyond anything that we could ever write.
Amen.
And God has given it to us.
Amen.
So the Bible, we need to study it and learn it as from a historical point. And I'm not saying we shouldn't just read it and study it. We should be doing that. Amen. But we know the book, and there's many books in the book.
That's right.
How many books are there?
66.
And there's how many writers?
One.
Well, there's one author.
40.
40 writers, amen? You understand that? But you need to know that from a historical point of view, amen? And these guys that were told by God to write, they wrote from every culture. That means that they were all different cultures.
Yeah. Right.
And they didn't sit down with each other and say, hey, Paul, you know what? Amos didn't sit down with Paul and conspire with him and say, you know, I'm writing this, and what do you think? You should write that?
Right.
None of these guys had any idea at all what the other one was writing. And God had brought all that together and brought in this great historical law, prophecy, poetry, everything that you could ever imagine in the Word of God, the epistles, you just name it. And it all focuses on redemption and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
It's all historical. You agree with that?
Amen.
We see the sermons that are preached by Jesus himself.
Right.
And by Peter and John. I mean, that should just get you excited.
Amen.
When you sit down and read. I mean, you shouldn't be able to sit still.
Right.
Of course, I'm just as bad as everybody else. But all those writers is just one book.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
And we got all that we can handle.
Right.
I wonder why we read so many other books.
Right.
I'm not saying it's wrong. Amen? We see that God has delivered us a book that's in unity.
Mm-hmm.
You can't find any errors.
No, sir.
You ever You ever argue with somebody with the Bible? They say, well, I know that the Bible says such and such. Yeah, just give me
chapter and verse.
Verse, amen?
Right.
Just tell them that. I mean, if you can show me the verse, amen, we'll go there and look at it.
Sure.
Most people don't know it.
Of course not.
Amen. And they want, and a lot of Christians do that now. They say, well, this is what I think the Bible says, whether you like it or not.
Right.
I've heard people say that. This is the way I feel.
Right.
It has no desire to go ahead and compliment you on what you think the Bible says.
Right.
You're there with me. You probably heard this before. It's an unbroken thread.
Yes.
It has a divine purpose. Amen. It has a thread that runs all the way through it, all 66 books.
Amen.
Somebody called it a purple or red thread, I guess. Amen. Crimson, yeah, that's the word I'm looking for. It just goes through every book. As sweet and as wonderful as it possibly can be. Little by little, as you study the historical value of God's word, age by age, it starts to build a picture for you.
Amen.
A purpose starts to unfold. You begin to see how you ought to live as a child of God. And Christ points us to himself on a regular basis all through it. It's just an exciting thing.
Amen.
I didn't know all this when I was a younger man of God. But as I'm getting older, the more time I spend with Christ, the more he awakens me.
Oh, amen.
Sometimes we have to get beaten up. Did you know that?
Oh, yeah.
Amen. Do we have to wait until we get beaten up?
Yep.
To get to that place, you say, well, I'm going to start studying the Word of God. Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, we say that, don't we?
Amen.
But I'll tell you what, when the rug is pulled out from underneath you, all of a sudden as a child of God, you say, okay. Amen.
Right.
I'll start now. Maybe it's too late.
Right.
But anyway, paradise is in there.
Yes.
Wow, could you imagine? Not a paradise, paradise. Amen. Where you can live forever and ever.
Amen.
I have no idea what it's going to be like, do you? Except for what the Bible says. Street of gold. Streets of gold. Imagine that. I understand that gold is so clear that you can see down through it. That's what the Bible says, right? There's just amazing things. Gates that go into the holy city. Wow.
Yes.
It sounds a little weird. That's what the Bible says. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So it talks about paradise lost, paradise regained.
Yep.
Amen. It was lost. Sin.
Yes.
We regained it.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
It's also, and I think people forget that. I'm not saying you all do now. But it's a book of human history.
Yep.
Yes.
Real history.
Right.
Not like the garbage we have today.
Amen.
Amen.
And no man can lay claim to it.
Right.
No man can build a culture for himself out of it.
Right.
You can only live by what God has told us to live by.
Amen.
Amen. There's only one history, and there's only one history of its kind, and it's called the Word of God.
Amen.
Wonderful lessons.
Yes.
One lesson after another.
Yep.
And sometimes I need it.
Sure.
You see people that become heroes. You see people like David in the folly, and God is always there to redeem them.
Amen.
Does that mean out of sin? God forbid, but it's there.
Right.
And all that stuff is embedded in the history of God's Word.
Right.
Amazing.
Yes.
And even though man tries to prove it to be wrong, man ends up being wrong.
That's right.
It talks about all those wonderful, remarkable races that are in the Bible.
Yes.
You know, we have all kinds of racism going on today.
Yeah.
It's just absolutely wicked.
Amen.
Isn't that right?
Amen.
But isn't it good that we have a God that embraces everybody?
Right.
That wants to be saved. Isn't that true?
Yep.
Amen. He's not looking for any particular group of people. He's not looking for any particular type of person. He's looking for sinners.
Right.
And that's all interwoven, and all that wonderful fortune is found on these pages in the Word of God.
Right.
Isn't that a wonderful thing?
Yes.
From Chaldea, Egypt, all through the Word of God. We know Egypt is a wicked place, and Syria, Babylonians, and of course Persia, Macedonia, Rome, and all that stuff is written right on these pages.
Right.
Now, I can't say that I don't like a good movie that has Roman soldiers in it.
Sure.
I like it when a soldier comes up and runs a spear through somebody. Amen. I know you're not violent people, but there's just something about that stuff. You don't watch that stuff?
No.
And then, before we get into the meat of what I want to teach you, amen, we need to preserve our faith. And it's going away.
Right.
We're becoming lame, lackadaisical, when it comes to studying the Word of God.
Right.
Right.
And sometimes I think it's because we don't know how.
Sure.
A lot of times. And,
sure.
And you know, like going to school, you know, the teacher always tried to teach me English. And when she'd write, we're going to, what do you call that section of sentence? What do you call that?
Diagram.
Oh, I hate that. I still don't know how to diagram a sentence, do you?
Yes.
Well, yeah, you would. You know what? I just hated that stuff about English. But praise the Lord that she hit me with enough erasers that at least I could speak. Amen? Isn't that good?
Yeah.
I got, well, I'm going to get to that. So, we need to look at the historical value of God's Word to be able to keep our faith where it ought to be.
Yeah. Right.
You know, we've been talking about Baptist history.
Amen.
And because we're true Baptists, we believe that we're Baptist, but we are Christian first.
Amen.
Yeah.
That faith that was based on the truth of the Word of God is dwindling away.
Yes.
Little by little. And I certainly don't want to pick up because I'm the same kind of preacher. I just want to preach.
Amen.
But sometimes we preach so much that we never teach.
Right.
Yeah.
And then we forget to give the truth to God's people.
Amen.
But God has brought us to this place where I believe I'm going to do my best to help you to see what God has given to me over these 40-some years of studying the Word of God. And there's a lot of truth in it. So let me put it to you like this. Growing up and stuff.
Sure.
Isn't it?
Yes.
And then all of a sudden you become an old man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I remember the childish things that I used to do.
Mm-hmm.
And not all of them, but with those things I had childish conceptions.
Yeah. Sure.
And of course, if I still believe that way, I would be insane.
Yeah.
But anyway, the absence of being a child brings me to a place where now I have to think like a man. Isn't that the truth?
Amen.
But here's something that's really important you need to understand. I remember growing up. I remember the old house I lived in. Y'all remember that, don't you? I remember the fields that we played in, running up and down the hills. When it snowed out, we would go to Franny Park. What's that, Lincoln Park, Lord? In Albany? Where we would wait for the snow to come, and we'd take our, we didn't have sleds, couldn't afford them. We'd take whatever we could to slide down the hill, cardboard. We'd wear the cardboard out.
Yep.
But we did all, I remember all that stuff. I remember swimming in brooks, don't you?
Amen.
Or in ponds. We had a pond on China Hill Road where if you got in the water, it actually had a, what do you call those things that attach themselves to your skin?
Leeches.
Leeches, yeah. You always got a leech at least once. Amen? Yeah, you know how you get a leech off? Burn it.
Yep.
Amen, Raven. You burn it off, but I remember all, I don't remember everything, and you're like I am, it's all, it's a dimension that used to be in my life, and it's unfortunate, but it's dwindled away.
Right.
It's good to go back there, it's not a bad thing.
Yeah.
It's kind of like being a child of God. We have forgotten what it's like when we got saved.
Right. Right.
We don't go back there anymore.
Right.
We don't visit that area.
Right.
When we used to be with the Father. Remember that day, that gracious day that God saved your life?
Yes,
we have enlarged so much
right.
that we forgot
yep.
our first love.
Yeah.
And so we don't want to study the Word of God because we've gotten complacent.
Yep.
So we cast our faith away.
Right.
And there it is. Ignorance is not really an excuse. Are you with me? I'm not trying to rebuke anybody.
Right.
I'm preaching to myself. Amen?
Sure.
So First of all, and I didn't write all this stuff down for you, and I will give you opportunity to write it down, so that way you can look at it later. Now, I know we believe in seven dispensations, and I'm not going to go into that tonight, but I want to give you three events that mark Bible history. Amen? And number one, the giving of the law of Moses on Mount Sinai.
Right.
If you go back and look at that, we know that's historical. You believe it, right?
Amen.
Okay, if we believe it, then we need to know where it is in the Bible and when it was given to us.
Amen.
Amen. At what time?
Right.
God wants that to be known to us.
Yes.
And then we need to know when the Holy Ghost came upon Pentecost. Mm-hmm. Amen. And then we need to even go to the end of it. I call the death of the last apostle. There are three great ages. And let me define that for you as best as I can. So we had the giving of the law of Moses. We have the descent of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost. And then we have the death of the last apostle. Okay? Three great ages. Of course, Jesus is the reason for all that.
Amen.
I know I didn't mention him, but we will. And they are defined as the patriarch age. You there with me? Patriarchs. Most of you know about that. That's from, 4004 B.C. to 1491. That's from creation to the giving of the law. From creation to the giving of the law. Amen? Okay. Second one is the Jewish age, which we've been discussing an awful lot, 1491 A.D. to 30 A.D. What was that for? The giving of the law and the coming of the Holy Ghost. Bible history. Would you like me to say any of those again? Okay, then we have what we call the Christian age, from 30 A.D. on. Let's say from there on, and of course, again, that's when we see the Spirit of God to the death of the Apostle John. Of course, we know that Jesus Christ came, died, and rose again on the third day. The characteristics, the way I see it, is of the family is first, family, revelation, family, religion, and then family government. If you go back and study that historically, right from Genesis, the book of Revelation, that'll become real to you. If you see the nation, the second idea, nation religion, that is, what is that called? The Jewish religion? What's the Jewish religion? Judaism. Amen. Amen. And the national covenant that God has given to them, which we've been studying, right? And tied to that, again, is the race of worldwide religion and message, which is the message that the Lord Jesus Christ has given to us. So with that, I gave you these papers, and this might help you if you go ahead and take time to study your Bible and use this as, let's say, just a guide. Amen? And so you have the antediluvian, and you say, antediluvian, what in the world does that mean? That means before the flood. Mm-hmm. And there's the years. You believe in the flood, don't you?
Amen.
Amen. From creation to the flood. You ever heard those words before? Those are Greek words.
Yep.
Amen. Before and after. I didn't write this, but I thought it was neat that you could use this to some degree in regards to history. From the flood to the call of Abraham, patriarchal age. And of course, that's the call of Abraham to the migration of Egypt. And if you want to use those all down, you're familiar with the wandering, the conquest, Judges, the kingdom, the double kingdom, and Judah alone. I thought it might be good for you to want to use that. Can you, if you want to, go ahead. If you don't want to, go ahead. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Okay, so let's, what do you say we get into Old Testament history? Amen?
Amen.
Ah! Now, I'm not going to go through all the details because I think most of us have had plenty of Bible study when it comes to Genesis.
Amen.
Amen?
Yes, sir.
But I'm going to give you some verses. Genesis, what's it talking about? The beginning.
Right.
Amen? We all know that.
Yes.
And generation.
Right.
And it's important that we recognize the word generation historically. Why? Because it's the book of origin. That not origin, the man origin, by the way. Amen? So we don't want to mess with that fella. Amen?
Amen?
But it gives us, if you will, the genesis of all things. Historically. Genesis 1:1, you're familiar with that. In the beginning, God created what?
Heaven and the earth.
The heaven and the earth.
Right.
It didn't say heavens, it said the heaven and the earth.
Amen.
So you'll notice when we go to Genesis 2:4, that we see that word generations, and the word generation continues on for 10 times, and it follows a pattern. I like the word generation, especially since my wife has been doing a, what do you call that when you send your spit in? Okay, genealogy. So she's beginning to discover where she came from. I told her I came from underneath the cabbage patch. Very cabbage patch. I don't know about some of you guys.
Bridge.
Amen. So Genesis 2:4. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth, or the earth, when they were what?
Created.
And the day that God, the Lord God, made the earth and the heavens. So now we see the word heavens, but we know He created those also.
Yes.
Amen. The heavens, not heaven. Genesis 5:1, this is the book of generation of who? Adam. Generations of Adam. And of course, it says in the day that God created man in the likeness of God, named him. You remember those verses? Genesis 6:9. And we have to put it in perspective, and also we have to put it in order. Genesis 6:9, these are the generations of Noah. We know that he was a just man and perfect in his generation. Remember that, don't you?
Yes.
Okay. Then Genesis 10:1. Now these are the generations of the son of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Mm-hmm. And unto them were the sons born after the flood. And we can also, Genesis 10:1 that was, and then we can go to Genesis 11:10, and these are the generations of Shem. Who is Shem? One of Noah's sons. So we know historically it was Noah and then his sons.
Yep.
Yes.
Amen. And God was always making reference to the seed.
Yes.
Always the seed, not the woman.
Right.
Well, the woman was a she was an important part of all that.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen. As Mary. So Genesis 11:27. Now these are the generations of Terah. And she begot who? Abraham. We know that's the generations. And now it says in Genesis 25:12. I said she, I'm sorry. But anyway, Genesis 25:12. Now these are the generations of Ishmael. Genesis 25:12. I think I said 10 first, but 25:12. Now these are the generations of Ishmael. And who is he the son of?
Abraham.
Hagar, the Egyptian. And then we have Genesis 25:19. And these are the generations of who? Isaac, Abraham's son. It's important that you have this all in order.
Sure.
If you're going to have the historical value of God's word. And then we have Genesis 36:1. Now these are the generations of Esau. And you can read on down through all those. I think we've had Bible studies in Sunday school that touched on all that. But again, we're looking at the historical value. When you sit down and read Genesis, we need to have a clear understanding of what God is talking about.
Right.
Genesis 37, 2, these are the generations of Jacob. Amen? And so we have 10 areas of generations that the Bible speaks about in regards to history. And that is, if you will, no accident. God had done that on purpose. I know there's Bibles out there today that, what do you call them? The Bible is in order.
Chronological
Bible. All right, but whether you have that or not, we have the Bible that has given us historical value that we need to lay out when we study the Word of God. And I think that the Bible was written intentionally by those people that wrote it because God laid upon themselves to write it. They wrote it as God told them to. And that's why we can prove that the Bible is the Word of God, because it all fits so wonderfully together. And so, with tonight, so we don't go any further, these characteristics, I think, that we look in the Bible are an amazing set of attractions, and it gets our attention if we really look at it that way. You need to know those things. So if somebody asks you, who are the sons of Noah, we should be able to know that.
Amen.
Amen? And who are the generations of Shem? So there, it goes on down to the Word of God. And so once we get that all in order in our minds, then we can go ahead and share with other people what the Bible says about particular things that they have question about.
Right.
We get in trouble a lot because we don't know the historical things of God's Word.
Amen.
Amen. So next week we're going to look at Genesis, the universe, starting out with Genesis 1:1, stuff you're familiar with. I'm not going to give a twist to it, but I'm going to give you a perspective I believe that will help me and help you as we go through this thing. And if you have any questions, don't ask me because I won't be able to answer. Amen. So we need to have our time of prayer. And let's close in prayer, and then we'll have our time of prayer. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, I pray that this might be an exciting journey. Lord, that you would help me to give truth, Lord, not my desire. And Lord, as I study these things, Lord, that you give me clarity, value, that Lord, I might be able to understand those things that, Lord, you would have me to feed your people. And we thank you for it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand. Yes.
Number 174.
My heart today.
Tanya. Williamson.
Just for specific on Dad right now, they kept him waiting for 20 hours for an MRI. They finally got the result today. And the problem is, I mean, he's got a messed up spot in his spine, which is what they're looking at long term. But right now, he's got a bunch of nerves in his lower back, like extreme lower back. They're all bunched up, and it's got like three major nerves. The sciatica is just one of them, but all three of them are bunched together, and it's like a giant knot. So right now, they're injecting injections directly to it, trying to relax that, because he's just in excruciating pain constantly because it's all his wires are crossed. So just pray that that would alleviate. Then they can start looking at what they're going to do with his spine. His problem is, in your vertebrae, you have a hole where your spinal cord goes.
Yep.
Dad was born with smaller hole than normal. So because his is out of alignment, normally it's not a big deal. But his is pinching his spine, which is what has caused all his issues. But the arthritis is built up around where it's messed up. So they have to fix this problem. Then hopefully they can break up the arthritic junk around it, be able to realign it, fuse it together, and that's all just conjecture on depending on what happens and if the surgeon is willing to take the chance. Because if he goes through the surgery, it could help him, paralyze him, or kill him. And Dad's like, let's try it. Because he's in pain constantly.
Oh, yeah.
So just pray the Lord would guide and direct and give the doctor to him, my dad, and mom. And pray for mom, and she's really, especially when Dad's in the hospital, it's really, really rough on her.
Yeah, the people that have to deal with those that are going through the pain, that's actually more difficult for them.
Right.
Anybody else have a prayer request tonight? Yes.
Traveling verses?
Amen.
We definitely would be praying for Gene.
Amen.
We're going to miss you. But we understand.
Sure.
Yes, Mark.
Travel mercy for our son Jeff. He's finished with school at Yorktown. He's going back home tomorrow.
No grandkids?
They've been back home for a couple weeks.
Okay. And Chris?
Just church union. Just want to pray for our church as a whole.
Amen. Lord, church. Somebody else? Yes?
Yes.
I know you are.
Yes, sir.
I'm excited about feeling much, much better.
Amen.
My sugar is under control.
Pray for more.
Amen. So, didn't realize how bad you could be with that. Wow. So anyway, let's pray. And I'm going to ask different men to pray for different people. And then I'll close with prayer, but you can stay if you like in your seat, or you can come up and kneel here, and I'll ask the different men, and I'll call on different men to pray. Yes, I'm sorry, John.
There's a little baby, he's only 2 years old, and he's got word that bones break if he does anything, and he's in a cast now. Could you please pray for him? I just know it's a Williams family, I don't know if it's the same.
Okay. Okay, let's, oh yeah, yes, Rosina. Don't be sorry.
Please pray for a family that
say it was?
Six.
Six?
Chris says six, Rosina says five.
And four.
Take the pick.
Seven, eight.
Who's last in line?
So, the mom's been asking for a lot of her, and we've been praying for her, but.
So, she, is that how they think you got autism?
His name is Nigel. It's how autism, they found out when he was very, very, very young.
Go ahead. Somebody else?
My brother-in-law dies, there's work, and my sister, he did get saved,
Amen. How long ago that happened?
He got saved probably, a week or two ago, and he's the one that I asked for prayer, that I,
Okay. Well, praise the Lord, he's in heaven. Anybody else? Okay, let's bow our heads, and if the men or anybody wants to come up here, and I'll give you people to pray for. Father, we come to you tonight with all these prayer requests, and we know that, Lord, you answer our prayers. Lord, I ask that you be, Brother Mark, if you would pray for Tanya Williamson and for her husband as they prepare to come here, but that she would continue to heal.
Father God, just be with Tanya and her husband, family, Lord, you know the issues they have, you know that you can heal. Be with them as they come here, Lord. God, safe travels for them, watch over them. Bless them, Lord, be with them. And in Jesus Christ.
Amen. I'm going to have a Raven, if you would pray for Rosina. Or she asked us to pray for a son that has autism. And also pray for Patty and her sister-in-law. As she's going through this time of losing her husband. Let's pray for Pastor Mike and for Charles' mom as he's going through this terrible time of pain, that he'll be able to have surgery. All that will become history. And I'm going to ask Brother Ron if you pray for Pastor Mike.
Dear Heavenly Father, I pray tonight you will put your healing hands on Brother Mike. Give him the relief that he needs from the constant pain he has all the time. I know that such things can really be stressful and can affect people's minds as well as their bodies. So I pray you give him the relief of healing, and also I pray you give his wife stamina to be there for him and give her the comfort she needs so that she can help him through his day and get encouragement from him. I pray you be with surgeons that have to do this work and got their hands and eyes that they would do the job properly, and pray it will be effective.
Yes, sir.
And that he would get the relief he needs in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Brother Mark, would you pray for Jerry Pearson? Had the heart catheterization recover.
Praise the Lord, Father.
Mike, if you would pray for Jeff McGiggins, he fell at work and at the ER.
Dear Heavenly Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would be with Jeff. Lord, Lord, even now in the hospital, Lord, just pray, Lord, that you'd put your healing hands upon him. I pray, Lord, that most importantly, Lord, that you'd be with him. And Lord, help him at work. Lord, let it all be covered by work, Lord, and let there be no financial hardship there. Lord, heal his body, Lord, but most importantly, spiritually. And I just ask, Lord, that, Lord, you're the great physician, Lord. You know what needs to be done, Lord. You know, guide the doctors, Lord. Lead them and give them the wisdom that they need, Lord. Thank you so very much, Lord, for what you're going to do. We just praise your name for it.
Amen. And Brother Chris, if you would pray for Angela Boston, throat surgery tomorrow. And pray for Sharon and Jean, Jean and her travel.
Dear Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for your grace and mercy that you've given us, Lord. Lord, we ask that you be with everyone that's traveling, Lord. Carry them, put them to their place safely, Lord, and ensure that they will get there, that they come back to us safely, Lord. Lord, we ask for the lady that will be having the surgery.
Yes.
Lord, I know it's hard to go through something like that, and I just hope that you give her the strength and the faith to trust in you, that she will get through it, Lord, and to know that only through you that everything can turn out the way it's supposed to. Lord, I just ask that you be with each and every last person, Lord.
Amen. Grover, would you pray for Mark's son Jeff as he travels? Give him safety.
Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for tonight, and ask that you would be with Jeff and them as they travel, just give them the cover, grace and mercy. Lord, would you just ask you to put a special hand, Lord, over their car as they travel. Just go with them and keep them safe. Lord, that's called from your son's name.
Father, I pray that you be with Pamela's unspoken. Many times we Christians have requests that's just between you and I, Lord, and we just want to hear from you. So let her hear from you, Lord.
Amen.
And Lord, we pray that she'll be able to let us know how you've answered that prayer. And then, Lord, Chris asks us to pray for the church in these times, Lord, that the people would be encouraged and strengthened, that, Lord, they would get hungry for the Word of God, hungry for the things of God. And Lord, we'll thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for this time of prayer. And Lord, as we close, Charles is going to be praying for several other people. And we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in thy house in the Lord Jesus Christ's name.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, first of all, we come before your throne with thanksgiving, Lord. Thanking you for the healing and the way you touched the pastor, Lord, over the past few weeks. Heart was hurting, and Lord, the things he's going through can be depressing. But Lord, I thank you for giving answers, Lord, with that
shoulder,
and Lord, the strength that you've given him. Lord, I thank you for that. I pray that you just continue to watch over him, Lord, and be with these treatments that he's going through. Lord, strengthen his body to be able to handle it. Lord, help those treatments be effective and not the rest of that junk down his body.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, be with Sister Anna. Lord, I have to talk on her, all the things that he goes through. Lord, as we had said before, Lord, the body standard, sometimes it's harder on them. I pray that you just strengthen this Anna and just continue to bless her and encourage her. Lord, I pray for Ellen Parisher, Lord, with a broken toe. I pray that you just touch and heal there. Lord, and just be with her and watch over her, protect her. Lord, be with her parents and family. They got some health issues going on. Lord, you know exactly what their need is. Lord, I pray that you just be well, Lord, to just move in that situation and provide healing as only you can, and you might get the honor and glory. Lord, I pray for Brother Glover. Lord, I certainly thank you for his godly example of Lord, just being so faithful, Lord, and you to your work.
Amen.
Lord, I thank you for him. I thank you for the encouragement he has so often times been.
Lord, he's always got a good heart about him. Lord, I thank you for him. I pray that you just meet whatever needs in his life. Lord, we know he has some health issues and the other things he goes through. Lord, and I know one of the heaviest things on his heart is for his daughter Melissa, Lord, and her family.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that you just encourage them to, Lord, if anyone in that family is not saved, I pray that you draw them unto you first of all. Lord, that they would look to you for the answers that they need. Lord, and get them back faithfully in church. Lord, and just be with that. Lord, I pray for brother's brother, Epp. Lord, we know he's still going to lose many people. Pray that you would just work in that situation, Lord, and just bless him. Lift him up as be will. Lord, give brother Grover peace with that. Lord, I know it's hard on him, too.
Yeah.
Pray that you just encourage him in that. Be with Gordon and Donna Lee. Lord, you know the health issues that they have. Lord, pray that you would just touch and work a mighty work there. Lord, be with Doris Riley. She needs special prayer, Lord, so we're asking you. Lord, we know that every prayer with you is special, Lord. I pray that you just touch whatever need is in her life. Lord, and just put your hands upon her and work in whatever situation is going on. Pray for Sister Jeff. I pray that we'd be faithful and pray for the things that she mentions, especially on these unspoken, Lord. As Pastor said, there's some time where it doesn't need to be voiced out loud, Lord. You know the need of her heart. And I pray that you just, Lord, answer her prayers. We know she's a faithful prayer. Lord, I pray that you'd be with her doctor's appointment coming up on the 13th. Lord, I pray that you just prepare even now, Lord, the doctors and nurses. And I pray that everything would go smoothly and it would be a good report. I pray for the visitors that we've had lately. Lord, I pray that those folks would return. Lord, I thank you for them. I pray that you just bless them. And Lord, with that, I also think of the folks who aren't in our presence. Lord, be with Brother James and Brother Jeff and Sister Beth. Lord, is there a way? Lord, just watch over them, protect them. Lord, just bring them back swiftly. Lord, we know your hands upon them. Lord, I pray that you just bless them and the things that they're doing and just bring them back soon. I pray for Shirley Catron. Lord, going through some sickness. I pray that you just touch and heal there. And also for Sally Fornash, Lord, continues to have health problems. Lord, I pray that you just watch over and touch her, Lord, and just heal her as would be your will. Lord, we thank you once again for this opportunity to come before your presence, Lord. We know so many times we just dump so many petitions before you, but Lord, they're nothing to you. Lord, we know that you're all powerful. You can meet these needs and without even before we can even ask them. So Lord, we're just ask you to hear our prayers tonight, Lord, and to have your will in each and every situation. We ask it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.